Yan and Mikey react. That was a bar, Mikey. That was a bar.
It's sunny. It chucked it down with rain. It's a lie.
It's raining and sunny.
Yan's just trying out Fallout 5 when the bombs drop.
I've kind of gotten a bit over Fallout.
I
found that I love playing the beginning of Bethesda games.
Yep.
And then I always get to the same point in the plot, usually about 2 hours in. It's like, hey, I'm bored with this. Let's start over. And I just replay the beginning.
So I was a big Oblivion fan, and I played it through a couple of times. I was like, hang on a minute. I don't have to keep playing the beginning. I can just quick save it, properly save it just before you leave the dungeon.
I mean, you have to do that with Skyrim, because otherwise you have to sit there for 15 minutes while they talk at you.
Well, you're a prisoner. You should be tortured. This is the feeling they're going for. Yeah, and I must have put hundreds and hundreds of hours into that game, but it was a really enjoyable game. About 2 years ago, so quite a ways after the original release, I played it again, but only this time played the main story, because I'd never played the main story before, apart from the bits it forces you through. So it's amazing how much content is in those games that people just miss out on. I mean, I missed out. The ending, though, it's many, many years after, so I'm not going to spoil it for anybody.
Q&A is on the 30th. On my YouTube, it said in 1 hour.
Ooh. There you go. Perhaps someone inadvertently scheduled it incorrectly.
I wouldn't know how that works.
Older games like that. I was very disappointed with the end. That giant red demon.
You and I had
really
interesting conversation speaking about old games, which is about text adventures.
Oh, so this is going to be like old Gits Part 2 or something along those
lines? Well, what's interesting is, okay, so Mikey and I are both old Gits, but we are different ages. I am older than Mikey, like by about twice his age or something, I don't know.
Yeah, something like that.
People used to tell me you're as old as you feel, and this doesn't make me feel any better at all.
Oh, dear.
Yes, we're making Skyrim. No, we are not making Skyrim in Godo.
Could you imagine that? That would be amazing.
I'm not saying that even as a joke on camera. So Mikey reached out to me and says, I think I figured out why I don't enjoy text adventures. And it's to do with how he reads. And then during the conversation, it turns out he's never actually played a text adventure. He means point and click. And to me, that's a completely different genre. Because I grew up playing things like The Pawn, P-A-W-N, which was a text adventure with the occasional picture in it. And text adventures were the most frustrating thing, because you had to guess exactly what they were, and the designers would go into these incredibly obtuse puzzles just to tease you.
Yeah.
So, for example, there was one thing where you just find a red, a green, and a blue. And you just find them. It doesn't say what they are. You examine them. It just says it's the reddest red. And then hours later, you've got to melt your way through the snow. And the solution is to mix the red and blue, and then mix the green and the red and the blue, and then use the white on the snow, and it will melt it.
How on earth are you supposed to know that?
You're not. This was pre-web. I'm not going to say pre-internet, because there were bulletin boards, right? The internet's been around for a while. But this was about 10, 15 years before the World Wide Web was invented. First one I played, was it called Dungeon? The one with the magic word was XYZZY, which is a meme you see in a lot of games. Oh, I mean, there were some amazing ones, like some of the classics from Infocom. The one that sticks out is Leather Goddesses of Phobos, which you had to be 18 to play.
I wonder why.
Well, in one room, the perverts lock you in a cell next to another cell where there's a gorilla, and then they swap your mind across. So you're stuck in the gorilla thing, and you've got to escape the cell.
Interesting.
And all of your stuff is outside the cell, but you can bring it in. And the solution is not to use the hose to get leverage, not to rattle the bars, is to eat the chocolate, wait for the sugar rush, and then bend the bars.
Of course, because chocolate gives you superpowers.
I was told the solution to this by a man on a plane.
That's better than the internet, isn't it? That is awesome.
Monkey Island puzzles are very abstract.
Yes, that's what I started talking about, wasn't it? I was saying, well, I consider things like Monkey Island, because you have to read the content rather than actually it be played out to you. Obviously, the later ones had audio voiceovers, etc. But the early ones, yes, and I really enjoyed Monkey Island. Fantastic game, and it drew me in. I think the humour was my kind of humour.
Hello, Misfit. I think one of the interesting things about those point-and-click games, in fact, the Discworld, Jilly just mentioned, Monkey Island is very similar to Discworld. The annoying thing was you had this very clear quest, and in order to solve it, you would always have to solve everyone else's problems first just to get one object.
Right.
And there's this amazing thing in Discworld where you've just solved all these puzzles, and you go up to someone, and the guy says, here you go then, here's your key, whatever it is. And your character, voiced by Eric Idle, says, well, you're just going to give it to me. Yeah, so here, just take the key. But don't you want to give me like a series of obscure puzzles? Not really. I kind of feel like you're wasting my time then. I mean, if you want, like, yeah, no, just give me a bunch of abstract things that can't possibly exist. Well, all right, then. And you're just sitting there looking at your character going, why are you doing this to me? Which tells me I didn't actually enjoy the process very much. I just watched the humor.
Mm-hmm.
It was a lot of like, I've got all these objects, I'll just keep interacting with things until they work.
There is a sailor who eats spinach. Popeye is his name, isn't it?
Yes. I love Death in all the Discworld novels. He's one of my favourite characters. In fact, everyone should read Terry Pratchett's Discworld novels. Especially from, I'd say the first one to really pay attention to is Mort. That's when he got into his stride. And then I would probably stop after Making Money. That's when his early onset Alzheimer's, that's a good word to forget the name of, started really affecting his writing. You back a Kickstarter for everyone to read Discworld. I would also back that Kickstarter.
There might be a few legal issues around that, but why not?
Terry Pratchett's work is responsible for my humour more than anything else. Like, my use of language and everything else comes from reading every Terry Pratchett novel that came out from the age of 14 onwards. And at one point, he was writing between 2 and 4 novels a year until he started getting heart problems from overwork.
2 to 4 novels a year. Wow.
Yeah. So we just do a full length novel in 3 months, start to finish, and just on to the next one.
Challenge accepted. No.
Rihanna Pratchett's going to rework some of her father's later novels. Fantastic. She's a very nice writer. She wrote Tomb Story. It's a really grim version of Toy Story.
I was like, where are you going with that? Hey?